Buenos días
a toda la audiencia.
Those following around the world, in the global north and global south, we're going to begin with this first part of this online seminary on Venezuela in struggle, colonial past, revolutionary legacies, and community regeneration. This opening session is we're very proud of it. I'm Hernan Vargas, members of the Venezuelan Settlements Continental ALBA Movement. I'll be moderating this first session. As we already said, we'll be reviewing the Bolivarian movement, Chavismo, as a political subject of this construction. Before starting with the first presentation by Reinaldo Iturriza, and since this is the first session, we would like to share with the various institutions organizing this meeting. We'll be accompanied by Carlos Ron of the Simon Bolivar Institute, Quinchilao from Global University of Sustainability and Cultural Research and Development, Lingnan University, Laura Capote of the Secretariat of ALBA Movement, especially responsible for training and formation, Pablo Kunich, coordinator of the ALBA TV Network. To start with the greetings, we would like to ask Kinchi Lau to please greet us. Kinchi, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Hernan. It is our great pleasure to be co-hosting this series on Venezuela. This is part of the South-South Dialogue for Sustainability, and this dialogue we have been starting since 1 month after the 7th South-South Forum on Sustainability. The first South-South Forum on Sustainability was held in December 2011, that is 10 years ago. And at that time, we had different organizers, mostly with Lingnan University, with the Renmin University of China, and also with the, and so we have been working to co-host the South-South Forum on Sustainability. And this year, it is our 7th year to do to host this. And we had about 150 speakers from 50 countries. After this South-South Forum on Sustainability, then there was a lot of demand to say that we should go deep into some of the issues. So that is why we have started this series, and we are very happy to be working together with many groups from Latin America, from Venezuela, and also from China. So the Global University for Sustainability was established in 2015, but the preparations went for 5 years already before that. And we had 200 founding members of the Global University. Among them were the renowned scholars like Samia Min, Francois Utah, and also many scholars from different continents. So with the Lingnan University, which has been the co-organizer of these events since 2011, and now we have the Center for Cultural Research and Development, which is co-hosting this event. And I am the coordinator of the program on cultures of sustainability. We are based in Hong Kong, and we have a team of about 15 full-time and volunteer members. So we are very happy that we are hosting this one, and we hope that there could be much more research and much more exchange among the different organizations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kinchi. Ahora, entonces, tendríamos el saludo de parte de nuestro compañero, nuestro camarada Carlos Ron, presidente del recientemente creado Instituto Simón Bolívar. Antes de ello, quiero hacer un comentario para todas las y todas las personas que nos escuchan.
We have a comment for those listening to us. In order to be able to have a translation into English and Spanish, you can check on the screen which channel you want to use, either English or Spanish.
Gracias. Adelante,
Thank
Carlos.
You very much. So, Carlos, you have the floor.
Muy buenos días, muy buenas.
Good morning, or good evening, or good afternoon. We are extremely happy to be able to participate in this opening of this seminar on Venezuela. I'm Carlos Ron, president of the Simón Bolívar Institute for Peace and Solidarity Among the Peoples. As Hernán said, we are a brand new institution. We have just commemorated our first month of activities, and we're extremely happy to receive this invitation of ALBA movement and the Sustainability University in China to participate. It is very important to share with other peoples, especially with the Chinese people, because in the current crisis, the capitalist dominating system is going through, one of the options of these people in the US has been aggressions against China, its people, and its institutions. We are calling upon against this new Cold War the United States wants to wage against China. And we want to get closer to the Chinese people and get closer to other peoples as well. This possibility to have a wide and diverse way to approach the Bolivarian Revolution, the current juncture in Venezuela, its people, organization, its government. It is a bright opportunity for us to deepen in our exchange. Therefore, we're extremely happy with this opportunity, and we hope to contribute as a new institute with our contributions to this analysis. And we are so happy to work with other Venezuelan organizations. We have a variety of visions, approaches. It's a wide picture of Venezuela. But we are convinced that in Venezuela, we want to build a brand new model, a new model of society, a model where our commitment with the justice, social justice prevails. And hopefully this space will facilitate dialogue, understanding. Thank you very much.
Gracias, Carlos.
Thank you, Carlos, for your greetings. We are going to give the floor to the Secretariat of the ALBA movements. Ms. Capote has the floor. Hello, brothers and sisters. Greetings. It is indeed a pleasure from ALBA movements to take part in the launching of this course and participate in its development. We are very enthusiastic. Hopefully together we can build during these months, a collective process of learning, listening to those brothers and sisters in the front line fighting for the Bolivarian Revolution, and us learning from that experience of resistance, construction of the people's power, and as both for Latin America and the Caribbean, it's so important to have the perspective of those on the other side of the globe that we can hardly see. And given the current pandemic, it is indeed difficult to see them, but now we can be closer thanks to these video conferences. This experience will enable us to know about the experience and perspectives of the people on the other side of the globe, to learn from the questions, the ideas. The Bolivarian Revolution is not only a flag belonging to Venezuela, it belongs to all those in Latin America and the Caribbean who try to follow on the footsteps of the liberator Simon Bolivar. Thank you so much to being with us, and we are thrilled to be here. And in ALBA movement with the social organization trying to build the alternative, Bolivarian alternative for our region, we are so thrilled to have and to listen the voices of those who are daily on a daily process of building a different world. So it is a huge challenge. Thank you very much for your enthusiasm. And hopefully in the coming lessons, we are going to have better contributions, reflections, and more commitment in order to defend the Bolivarian Revolution and to defend the sovereignty and the self-determination of the peoples. Thank you very much for these beautiful and energetic greetings. Now, Pablo Kunic from the ALBA TV is going to greet us as well. We are very happy to take part in this seminar so we can exchange the struggle of Venezuela as a media, popular media, one of the war fronts against Venezuela has been the media and cultural front. Therefore, with the Commander Chavez and now with Maduro, we need to conduct a cultural revolution. This course, this seminar, is a tribute to this effort to be able to communicate among peoples, to overcome the media siege against Venezuela and against the processes conducted in Latin America and other regions of the world and in the global south. Welcome, thank you for this opportunity, and we call for dialogue, debate, and this seminar hopefully will help us to get together and closer together. Thank you. Thank you for your greetings. Jade,
yeah,
of the Regional Exchange Center of Asia.
Yeah. Hello, everybody. My name is Xue Cui, Jade Margaret from Asian Regional Exchange for New Alternatives. An arena was established in Hong Kong. Was established in Hong Kong, China in 1980s. It is a regional network of concerned Asian scholars, academics, intellectuals, activists, researchers, writers, and artists, which aims to contribute to a process of people-oriented social transformation. We also reach out to link up with academic institutions and social movements in the world. Since 2001, we have been a member of the International Council of the World Social Forum. Since 2011, we have helped co-organize 7 Sub-South Forum on Sustainability. We sent a delegation to attend the Sapacista International Conference during the mid-1990s, as well as facilitating exchange program with Brazilian Landless Workers Movement, MST, over the past 10 years. We hope we will have more interaction and collaboration with Venezuela and Latin America in the future. This online course is the first step. Let's work together to strengthen people's friendship between Asia and Latin America. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jade, for your greetings from the Global South, from Asia. Now, as greetings. The Ecotechnological Green Ground Center, the representative, Tichang, please take the floor.
我是来自罗源乡间的孩子熊，国营乡间是在中国大陆，由著名三农文体专家温铁军教授指导的一个乡间机构网络联盟，在我们国营乡间有参与乡村建设一线实践的公益组织，也有一些是社会企业，还有一些在。
We are a group of people, some of us are in academic area and some are just university students, but we are all very interested in rural reconstruction. We opened an account of Bilibili since April, and also because of COVID-19, We opened an account in Bilibili, and we are very happy that there are many young people and younger generation who are a fan of Professor Wen. So our organization, together with the Rural Reconstruction Movement, together with the team from other rural reconstruction movement, we have some online lecture and live stream on the Bilibili. And this series is on Venezuela and how it is reconstructed. And every Wednesday evening, we do this live stream on Bilibili, and everyone please share. So please watch this online course and live stream, and get to know more about our international movement. And so our organization is in charge of the live stream on Bilibili. And if you have any question, please send me a message and send questions to us. We will collect your questions. And after, in the Q&A session, I will ask the question. And that's it, thank you.
Thank you, Brother Chichan. Well, this first seminar online is precisely an exercise of integration from the bottom, from various organizations, through the solidarity among the peoples, building process of linkage between Latin America, Asia, Africa, and Europe, building links between the Global South and strengthening links between Venezuela and China, between Latin America and Asia. We're extremely happy to be able to be part of this construction process. We are transmitting with three languages, with Mandarin, English, and Spanish, in order to be able to reach activists, militants around the world, wishing to know the truth of Venezuela. As you have mentioned, this is a course told in first person. For 4 weeks, you will be taught by people, militants working in the field on a daily basis in the rural areas, productive communes with linkages process, building social movements, the program available in the web pages in the Global University of Sustainability ALBA movement web page. In all those resources, in all those pages, web pages, you can find the program and the content. And there, we are talking about 10 weeks this year and 14 weeks next year. They will enable us to review the current struggles in Venezuela, the popular struggles, but also we will be able to listen to militants, committed scholars. So today we are going to have Reinaldo Iturriza giving us a general framework on the building of Chavismo. Next, we know about the rural communes, communal fighters, Del Maizal commune, Che Guevara commune, Pueblo Pueblo effort. But we also see the urban experience, the Olidice commune, Alexis Vive commune, the settlers movement, but also we need to approach those from the feminist groupings, those feminists who are working in various areas. Also, we talked about alternative communication, communication from the bottom, as ALBA TV experience, another grassroots TV experiences and media experiences, process of alternative constructions, popular economy, alternative economy. And also, this should enable us to see what Venezuela is from inside, to grow from the concrete level to the more general levels, to see the progress accomplished by the Bolivarian Revolution and the challenges that we are facing as a result of the blockade. Venezuela has been the target of unilateral coercive measures by the US. These are imperialist, interventionist measures also applied to other countries. Given the crisis of the empire, then trying to impose on others using force. Next year, we're going to enter a second stage of the seminar. And there we're going to analyze the origins of our struggles with Iraida Vargas, Anoja, the independentist struggle, the historical origin with Duque. Also, we will review the construction process of the economic and social construction of our country, how the harassment occurs through other speakers. Therefore, this is going to be a global overview of the process. So the academics, scholars, activists of the global north and global south can understand the current and historical struggle of the Venezuelan process. In a nutshell, they're going through a very difficult moment. This is the worst imperial attack ever suffered. But at the same time, we have the contradiction, not of socialism, as Trump says, saying that our crisis is the result of socialism. Contrary, socialism and the germ of socialism has enabled us to resist. The struggle of the people have enabled us to defeat and to resist against the aggression. This is a systemic crisis of our civilization. This is seen through the COVID crisis, but also we can see it through the Yankee crisis and the attacks against people such as Cuba, China, and we are all facing this global attack by the empire to defend our sovereignty. Within this very global framework, let's then talk about this first session. Let's explain the method. There will be we are going to have a keynote speaker, Reinaldo Iturriza, writer, sociologist, militant of the Bolivarian Revolution, and there he has analyzed the various periods of the struggle, and he has not only analyzed this from the theoretical perspective, but he have also had concrete roles at the head of the commune ministry. It is not a vacuum debate. This person has gone through an intense participation in the revolution, and he's going to talk about the construction of the Bolivarian Revolution from the very beginnings, from the historical roots, and how participation has been built, and what it means to build a process whose objective is to transform the social, cultural, economic basis of our society today. So Reinaldo will discuss on the tensions, the disputes implied in this process of construction from the grassroots. Once he concludes his presentation, we are going to receive comments of the first panel that we already greeted at the beginning of the seminar. And then every one of the organizers will make comments based on the intervention of Brother Reinaldo. And we thank him because he has made a huge effort to be able to send this presentation. We have some problems with the connections. One of the way sanctions express themselves is the difficulties we have with services, with public services, and the actions have been affected. Brother Reinaldo won't be able to share with us the question time. However, we will be able to debate on his presentation. We, from here, from as moderators, will be able to answer some of the questions. So without further ado, please, we are going now to listen to Reinaldo Iturriza.
I would like to talk to you for the education of the history in this course of colonial past and revolutionary history, and to thank the Global University for Sustainability, the Continental Platform for ALBA Movements, the Simon Bolivar Institute, the Center for Research and Cultural Development at the University of Lingnan, ALBA TV, the Asian Cultural Interchange for New Alternative, and the Ecotechnological Center at Greenbelt in China. Thank you very much to all of you for the invitation to participate in this seminar that we are starting today. I will talk about the Bolivarian Revolution and Chavismo. There are many things that we could say about this very vast topic, but I would try to focus on the Chavismo as a political subject. And I will focus on the subjectivity process of Chavismo as well as on the political tensions that this has implied all over the years. Of course, I will give you an overall view of this topic because we do not have enough time to develop, to go deep into this topic. But I am sure that during the seminar and with all the participations of
several partners in different sessions, we will go back to this topic and to other topics as well in detail. I would like to start by what I called, what I once called, 12 Pieces on Chavismo. In my view, these are pieces that are actually not classified by hierarchy order. But these are pieces that explain what Chavismo is. First, Chavism was created over the last decade of the 20th century, a very virtuous decade of the Venezuelan politics. And there was the beginning of something new that was beginning with the 21st century. It was the decade of Chavez and the catacombs of neoliberalism, of the nascent bipolar world. But it is not possible to fully grasp what the Bolivarian Revolution was back then. Number two, the old parties of our country, such as Democratic Action and other parties as well, coexisted. The Chavismo people came from other places, from union, from the people, with the institutions of the state and with the formal labor market. Of course, there were Chavistas of the middle class who belonged to the union and who worked with the politicians of the time, but Chavismos, real Chavistas, were not coming from those backgrounds. The real Chavistas, this is number three, come not from the people themselves. Number four, we recognize in the political tradition of the left, the revolutionary left, and this is where Chavismo comes from. And Chavismo led a revolution in spite of the Venezuelan left. And I would like to say now that Chavismo is not a political subject that was born against the revolutionary left. On the contrary, the revolutionary left identified itself with the Chavismo. There was not distinction between both of them. Number five, Chavismo is the emergence of a new political culture that uses the representations of different representations and the different ways of political representation. Number six, the most important political creation of Chavismo were the communes, the participation of the people, always working in communes and municipality communes, in self-governance, and popular self-governance, where the policies of the communes were established. And it was thanks to this protagonism of the communes, but you can see the breaking off with the barbarism of the civilization that entranized the leaders in spite of the masses. Number seven, Chavismo produces a new kind of militancy, and it does not go through only the material considerations or advantages, economic advantages. Number eight, it's about the protagonism of the working classes. Number nine, there is a specific way of doing politics according to Chavismo, which guarantee the equilibrium of the internal forces, always given the priority to the subject, to the individual, which is at the center of the Chavismo. Number 10, there is a way of governing according to Chavismo that gives a priority to the people, that limits the distance between the institution and the people, that wants to build democratic democracy without any kind of exclusions, guaranteeing room for those who have a different thinking. 11, Chavismo is anti-capitalism, and it questions the rentier economic system based on oil. Oil which was associated to capitalism and which was pretty much present in the Venezuelan economy. Chavismo is the popular answer to problems that come from this kind of society. And number 12, Chavismo is not an order. It's not only one way of thinking. Of course, there is a Chavismo thinking with its roots and traditions, but it's a pretty diverse movement. Chavismo promotes a different lecture, a different reading of history from a popular perspective. So, on the first pieces related to the virtuous decade of our political history, I'm just going to read some of pages, I will not have time to read all what I would like to read about Chavez in the 90s. But I am sure that this, what I'm going to tell you is what is less known about Chavismo, which is the historical conditions that were a place back then in Venezuela. What was happening in Venezuela when Chavismo emerged? What was the breaking up in our society? Because you do not know what happened, or maybe you do not know what happened in the 90s here, and what happened, you know, probably what happened after Chavez won in 98. And it seems that it was something that, you know, happened all of a sudden, but it is not like that. We are going to see the 90s so that you can understand. In July 1992, the movement NBR 200, which was the Bolivarian movement, gathered different rebels that were opposing the Carlos Andrés Pérez government, and they published a document called How to Get Out of the Maze. And they wanted to tackle the social problems of Venezuela, and they used different political forces in Venezuela to create a new situation and to start a profound structural transformation of Venezuela's situation. The new situation was to create spaces for participation, for broad participation, given all the protagonism to the Venezuelan population. The participation of new political and social forces, the main idea was participation, antagonistic participation. And this is going to be the central axis of the profound transformation in the political life in Venezuela that occurred during the 20th century. It was, without any doubt, a virtuous statement in our politics. According to Chavez, this idea was born when he was in jail. And he said that this was a leap, a big change, a epistemological breaking off. It was the bridge that made it possible to go from democracy to revolution without being a democracy. And according to Chavez, this idea of protagonism was already in the blue book that was written by Chavez himself in 1991, and who was adopted by the MBR movement that epitomizes his politics with the tree of three roots. He was questioning the traditional political parties and the traditional politics that had very narrow limits that prevented the society from participating in the making decision process. And the concept that he was proposing was to broaden those limits, to give the people the opportunity to participate and to make decisions. Now, how to do this? How to go over the limits of the bourgeoisie to gain popular protagonism? For that, the political system needed to put in place the necessary channels locally, regionally, and nationally through which the power was going to be given to the people so that neighborhoods, villages, cities had the necessary mechanisms to establish a self-governance system that will allow them to make their own decisions. This is what Chavez said in 1991. Now, with these ideas in mind, and convinced that new forces needed to gain power in Venezuela, and preconceiving this way of local governance, Chavez went out of jail on March 26, 1994, and he said, "For the time being, I have nothing to do and at the government palace at Miraflores. Before that, I am going to the catacombs of the people." And he decided to go to the people because he was criticizing the traditional way of doing politics, and he was ready to reinvent politics for Venezuelans to help them out of the maze. And how to explain this epistemological breaking up? Well, as he was gaining force, as his ideas was gaining force, the way in which he established a relationship with the individuals was quite unique. He understood that another subject, another individual was his equal. And thanks to that, he could establish the commune politics, which is a repoliticization of the militancy that had to forget the traditional way of doing politics through the representation system and to go to a protagonistic popular democracy where he or she is the protagonist of the whole process. And Chavez said, people know what they want and people know what they do not want. When I talk about people, about politics, I give them precise, concise examples, and I always respect them. And in Guasalito, in the Apure state, in 1995, he started this whole movement, and he said, Chavez said, "These are processes where the people are no longer the object, now they are the subject, and this revindicates the original history that they have hidden from us. In spite of everything, those events are a proof of a people, of the people who are renewing their hope in a transformative forces. We believe in the people forces, in the people struggles. We believe in Albert Camus, in the rebel man. We believe in solidarity. And I believe that those are going to be events that we are going to see in the forthcoming years. This transformation from like the people conceived as an object and transformed into a subject. That is the whole main idea, point of the quotation. So it is not just about having this relationship with a popular individual. Of course, always respecting our citizens that know what they want. It is not enough just by recognizing the forces of the popular transformation. But when he went to this town, who was Guasalito, he understood the cultural transformation that was taking place in those inner cities. And he also understood that those individuals understood very well the needs of our country. And this was opposite to the general idea that the people are ignorant, and quite on the opposite. He understood by understanding the layman what the reality was. So this is how he understood this. And I believe that our movement, he says, has gone to the roots and is trying to take away this spider web and the dust over our history. Our history that is there in our citizens' heart. We need to look for this history. We need to go to the dark places to find out what we are and what we can become. And by this, he was
expressing his willingness of unraveling the mystery of what our people could be. He was discovering the political identity of Chavismo. Chavismo, who is like a Bolivarian movement, and he decided to go back to our history. So very seldom you have the opportunity to have access to these historical movements that can clarify how everything took place in such a transparent manner. However, Chavismo's birth is always described as the emergence of the something that is commonly said. Sometimes they do not want to acknowledge one of the important variables of the equation, which is the individual. And sometimes they want to ignore the leadership, Chavez leadership, who was qualified as a caudillo. But Chavez is differently. Chavez thinks that he can understand the people, because the traditional politicians were always putting the people aside. They considered the people as useless people. And Chavez was quite opposite to this idea. Chavez said, I am not a myth, I am a reality. And as Aristotle used to say, myths always have something that is true. So this is pretty much present in the Venezuelan society of the 80s and the 90s. Chavez says, hope has always been in the people's heart. The people wanted to dream, and they wanted to dream for their, they wanted to have access to this possible, to this future, possible future in their dreams. So in the collective imagination, the desire of a new country with more equality and less corruption was being formed. And this was not a myth with a classification per se. It was a myth of the hope. And Chavez says, that was my vision, to give substance to this hope, to make the people believe that this possible country could be a reality. I was to create a foreseeable future, a myth that could be materialized, so that this myth of a new Venezuela could arise. So, the same way the courtesan poets sang about what happened in history, the left wing was going to denounce Chavez's leadership because they had an autonomous stance for the people. And several members of the left wing said that Chavez was a caudillo, and they started criticizing their stance. And Chavez says, those political parties from the left did not understand anything. They were just there for the electoral opportunities. Chavez said, they wanted to destroy me. And Chavez confronted to that reality, understood that what the traditional politicians wanted was to have an office. It was the degeneration of the real politics. Chavez says, we recognize that did not care about labor, they did not care about education or health, part of the quotation. And where there was the real politics, sector of the real politics that he could see on the people's willingness was on fire. They were looking for something. And he started this process. He could see in the eyes of the people a desire for the revolution. They were demanding, they were expecting a social revolution. And there was a general strike in February 1995. And thanks to this strike, he could understand the magnitude of that transformation. And Chavez says, there is not one single political party that is addressing this struggle. We can see groups of social movements and the grassroots movements, and Guazalito actually is a city that is nearby the border with Colombia. And Chavez says, there were just few groups working, but there is no organization. We can see members of the military that are not organized and that are supporting these strikes, the hunger strikes. And Chavez thought, well, what is happening here? And when he got to those villages, he started to see what the people thought, what the peasants thought, what the students thought. And he said that he had several exchanges with the people. And Chavismo, this is very important to understand, Chavismo was born in the midst of a very severe crisis of the traditional ways of doing politics in Venezuela. In the 90s, this is where we see this crisis more in an obvious manner, starting with the political parties. Chavez says, I was sure that with that political parties, those political parties that existed, it was because Chavez was always at odds with this political party. So he says, with that political forces, it would have been impossible to break the system, not through an armed or unarmed revolution. So this crisis was worsened after the government of Rafael Caldera in 1994. And this meant the definite rendition of the political process. And some political parties gave their support to Chavez. And Chavez said, I think that all these parties only wanted to occupy public offices in the regional or international elections. They were not really interested in tackling or addressing the people's problem. And Chavez says, not only political parties were in crisis, political movements as well were fighting each other, and there were some student movements that we got in contact with, that this was left wing movement that was destroyed. And one day I said, I am very tired of meeting and with holding all these useful meetings. I am going to take to the streets and I'm going to talk to people. And we see in this crisis also the participation of some scholars. And he's just saying to scholars that I think we have to go to the battle and we have to be pretty active. We need to take risks. Sometimes I think that you have to be more aggressive. You have to put your revolution, to prove your revolution in the battle. You need to advance this instead of just dreaming about theory. And the Bolivarian movement was the result of a very broad discussion that was given by the people as a collective individual. On April 1995, Chavez said, we're talking about the Lingnan. We're not talking, when you talk about scholars, you are leaving aside the people. And the people can also think and can also have an intellectual sense. For instance, the peasants that are confronting the military. We need to go and learn from them. We need to understand that moral, that philosophy, because the people is invited in also in the scholar book. So sometimes the scholars ignore the reality of our people and the immorality of our society. So this crisis, there is also a force that was unleashed and to see these forces. And it was possible to gather those forces. Those historical circumstances defined a kind of leadership that characterized Chavismo. And Tavis says that between the leader and the masses,
there were no intermediaries or parties, because the organization was just beginning, no intellectuals. Chavez and the people, he says. In July 95, he says, there is a huge vacuum of leadership in the worker, peasant, in the neighborhoods, but given that vacuum and historical situation, we need to commit to transform the collective science in action.
Into action.
Since then, the Bolivarian movement tried to transform the people's power and transform it in force, real power, concrete power that can move forward to change what exists as a counter power, as a theoretician of power,
was
a power against another power,
but
that power that has been created against the constituted power should be very big. If that power is not mobilized, accelerated, if it doesn't have a strategic meaning, we won't be able to topple constituted power. We have hundreds of thousands of people that we need to accelerate it. We need to speed it up. It is dispersed, says Chavez. And here we enter another key point. Very important to pay attention to this. And we'll refer to this later on. On May 1993, Chavez in prison, in jail, he writes a letter to Reina Arias, the letter to this sergeant Reina. The document is a document against the abstentionism, a position of the MBR 200 in relation to the election that would take place in 93 in December. At the end of the letter, he says, on the other hand, abstention will be 30 or 40%. And it's become the electoral event of this century. You have 2 million people who do not ever even register in the electoral record, which means that at the time, abstention in Venezuela was very, very high. So people from the marginal class, and this section is very important. Abstention, according to the most optimistic calculations, must be 20 or 30, which is the phenomenon, the electoral phenomenon. 2 million people, mainly coming from the marginal people. And this class keep on growing and today represents the terrain where the seeds of future changes have been planted. So the marginal class represents the terrain where the seeds of future changes have been planted, which is a very important sentence. It's very important. What is the marginal classes? In 95, 2 years later, he used the same words to talk about the subject of the Bolivarian Revolution. And he dispels the doubts. He says, the Bolivarian movement has an impact on marginal classes. The poor neighborhoods, the fields, the rural areas, the indigenous areas. There we see the furor, the fervor of people trying to abandon this poverty and misery. Difficult for them to force us to serve interests different from the interests of the marginal and poor people. That is the target of the movement. Therefore, we need to focus our actions for transformation towards those marginal classes. And that's April 1995. This diagnostic explains why Chavez devotes so much time to these capital discussions. The Bolivarian movement is left or right, is it Marxist, etc. In 1996, in order to create a provocation, Chavez distanced with Marxists, well, the left that existed at the time. Chavez said, the solution is not in Marxism. I'm not ignoring Marxism, and we have to go beyond Marxism. It is not the solution. It is important, but not the solution, especially for us in these conditions where we do not have any vestiges of working class. I've made an effort in trade unions, in factories. We've made proposals to union leaders to create a union movement. There are some progress, but what is the union and the worker force? That's the end of the quote. In that year, in February, he reflects, where can we place our target ideologically? To the left or to the right? Well, first, not this framework. We have a mass party. The mass party is to the left, but they are supporting a right and reactionary government. PCV, they were also supporting the right. MEP, also a socialist party in the past, is now part of the right-wing government. If we review the Soviet Union, Felipe González in Spain, I think it's the end. This is the world where, from the ideological point of view, parameters have been lost. I do not share the idea of the end of ideologies by the fact that we do not have a reference from the right or the left. We are trying to find a point of reference, original, local, of an ideological movement that could be adapted to the Bolivarian, Samorian, and Rodriguean approach as an expression of an epoch that was born here. It doesn't belong to the right or to the left. If we need to be defined, well, we are a revolutionary movement, a popular movement in favor of the cause of those who have been dominated in this world, in favor of justice and in favor of the revolution. It is a revolutionary left, and he is having a discussion with the so-called left parties of the time, or what was called the left at that time. The Bolivarian movement had identified the subject on the terrain, and it has decided to devote all the effort to that subject. The left had no terrain, and it has no subject, even though they were speaking about the working class. Before leaving jail, Chavez decided to go to the Capanaparo, which is a region in Venezuela. He decided to go to the Capanaparo in Apure with the Indians. And from there, he started this mobilization around the country. The close colleagues tell him not to do that, but to start rather in Caracas. So instead he goes to Coche, Petare, which are the parishes of Caracas, instead of going to those remote areas. So in June, he has already visited the country. 4 years later, he has visited the whole country for four times. So five times, rather, he visited the whole country. He went to the gallows and never left. He understood that the key was the protagonism of the people. So Chavez says, I think the people has been the protagonist, sometimes more, sometimes less, of a historical process. Today, our vision is based on that conception. We have discussed this. Without collective, there is nothing. Only the people can save the people. Here, there are no saviors, no messiah. If there is no popular organization and a well-orientated organization, there is no change possible. So he is convinced of the need to promote popular governments. So here we see the origins of Chavismo. And there we see the dramatic changes that occurred during the virtuous decade, namely a political revolutionary leadership linked to the people as equals. People politicized to become a protagonist and with transforming forces. The end of the Chavez myth and the born of a people myth. The people rebirth. People who wish to dream and want to fight for the dreams. People with social revolution. The end of the traditional mediation, legitimation, illegitimation of the traditional parties. The work with new forces based on reality, with the leadership forced to abandon the traditional political mediation and rather going towards the political forces directly. Identification of a subject, marginalized peoples, the marginal peoples, hit by neoliberalism, ignored historically, the vindication of ideological reference based on our history and culture. So see all that happened in the 90s, in a very few years, and there is more. Others also talk how people were not fearsome. The credibility of the left and right parties, that credibility was destroyed. It was increased credibility in the new offer. I think that in any other country, we have today the idea of nation, the proud of having a different country, and you can feel it in the grassroots movement. That is 95 when Chavez says this. In 98, in the midst of the political campaign, he says, and pay attention, we are working on the consciousness of people. Even if we have the money to distribute goods to the people for them to vote for us, we cannot do it. We are talking to the people. We are not telling them what they wish to listen to. Ask them to assume their responsibility to share in the organization of a large social front, which each one should make a contribution, not only from the material standpoint, but from the spiritual, intellectual point of view, with his work and intellect. Venezuela will never be the same since. All this happened, and Venezuela and Chavez was not even in Miraflores. He finally won the elections in 98, and after that, he gets to the Miraflores Palace. When I took possession of my position in 99, when I got to the palace of Miraflores, I saw Alberto Fujimori, Menem, the Prince of Asturias, and the oligarchy was there to praise me. All the oligarchs, Cisneros, Ascuro, the richest families, the bourgeoisie, I was enraged. I made my campaign thinking about the poor and the marginal, and at the end, the people, the forgotten people, they were not there represented. So the drivers, the escort, the people, and Fidel Castro was there, and he asked me, "Is this the Fifth Republic?" He said, laughing at me. So Chavez understood that even that revolutions are not conducted from the palaces. Revolutions are conducted with the people in the gallows, in the dungeons. It is not from Miraflores. And to be in the palace has a meaning if you are convinced that you are going to lead the revolution from the palace. So this is the end of this text regarding the virtuous period of the politics. We need to understand what happened in Venezuela in the 90s, otherwise you cannot understand what happened since 98 and 99. This is a period of which we can talk a lot. Those are the origins of the revolution. However, I wanted to discuss this aspect because despite the ignorance that still exists regarding the revolution and its origins and what happened later and what has happened since, well, we know very little about the 90s. So I would like to then stop on some punctual elements. The marginal classes, for instance, the subject of the revolution. When we talk about revolutionary processes, the discussion usually occurs very frequently, and it gives rise to a lot of polemic, and well, Chavez is very harsh, and is a very good polemist, is a provocateur, heterodox, very audacious. So he questions, what is the working class? Well, the working class exists materially, it is there. However, he wonders where it is. Where is the working class? Where is the organized and mobilized working class being the protagonist of the changes of the country? He is very critical. Well, instead of criticizing the working class as such, he's criticizing the left party. However, we need to analyze in detail the way the class structure has evolved in Venezuela since the 70s. At the time when the scholars identify the paroxysm of the capitalist rentier system of Venezuela in the period of the shoddy Venezuela, the wealthy Venezuela. But there we can, in the 70s, we can see already the exhaustion of the system, of the model. And we need to work on this aspect to analyze Venezuela in the medium long term, not only in the last 20 years or even less in the last 5 years, what has happened with the war, with the economic warfare. We need to have a long term view regarding the class system. Why Chavez talks about marginal classes in the 90s? Why? This is just a footnote, but it should give us a motivation to conduct in-depth research on this period. And this is part of the research I've been conducting on this matter. There are some interesting indicators between the first quarter of 75, and we're in the midst of the rich oil Venezuela, and the first quarter of 83, the informal workforce was below 40%, reaching 31% level in the second half of 1978. Very low for a country like Venezuela. Those are the years of the boom, and the employment percentage was above 90%. And the second half of 78 was at the lowest level of unemployment, 4%. Informal, unemployed, 35% of the labor force. Informal and unemployed, one third of the labor force in Venezuela. Informal, are they marginal classes? No. We need to discuss something that we don't have the time to discuss this right now. However, part of the informality in the labor force with high revenues is not the norm. The informal labor are precarious workers. People without a formal link with the labor market. And they do not enjoy the rights and benefits of a formal labor market. They are the victim of the deregulation of the market, etc. Flexibilization of the market that will happen later on in the 80s or the 90s. So this indicator of informality is very important. Informal worker is not protected, is unprotected. The situation I'm describing changes in the second half of 83. Informality is more than 40%, is 41.3%, and unemployment is more than 10%. So, in the second half of 83, between informals and unemployed, they account for half the labor force, 51% of the labor force. And that situation will not change in the coming years. And that situation will never change in the coming years. The first half of 94, when Chavez is describing the situation and discussing the situation of the working force and the work, the informality is above 45% informality in the labor market. And with the unemployed, they account for 55% of the whole labor force. And that is in 94. In 96, the first half of 96, few years later, Chavez was already in the dungeons. It is discussing with the left parties and the working class. Well, in that first half on 96, the informal labor account for 49% of the occupied labor, almost half, and plus the unemployed, 11%. They, for the first time in our history, they account for 60% of the labor force, 65% of the labor force. Therefore, almost two-thirds of the labor force between informals and unemployed. So In the economic and labor fields, these are the marginal population. Those are the precarious class or subproletariat, according to other scholars. So informal and unemployed, they account for the marginal population or people with a job, but they live in poverty. So that's the proletariat in classical terms, the subproletariat and the proletariat. This is very important to understand because my hypothesis is that Chavez, the core of Chavism, the Sabbath, what I call the Sabbath, the wild Chavism, the heart of Chavism, the marginal classes mentioned in the 12th thesis, the core, the popular core of the Chavista movement is the subproletariat. Although in the 98, you have a diminished middle class still voting for Chavez. In 2000, 2001, before the watershed of the coup attempt against Chavez, at that time, in that watershed, the majority of the middle class will go against Chavez. And it is going to be the pillar of the anti-Chavismo movement. Even though part of the middle class supported Chavez in 98, 99, and the subproletariat that voted for Chavez, well, that subproletariat is going to be essential to support Chavez against all the attempts to depose him. The subproletariat says, even though I'm hungry, I will still vote for Chavez, and so on. They are the majority of those supporting Chavez in 2001, 2002, and they are key in order to reach the victory in the referendum in 2004. So, for many reasons that we cannot discuss here because of time limits, that fraction of the class, they are not left with movement. But in 2006, when Chavez started to talk about socialism, they identified themselves as socialists. They identified themselves with the left. But at that time, the left is not the same left, that Chavez challenged in the 80s and 90s. It's another left. So, in the first semester, the first half of 96, the first time in our history that informal and unemployed account for 60% of the labor force. Informal and unemployed go below 60% in the second half of 2005. It took almost a decade for finally to go below 60%, almost at the end of the first period, the first term of Chavez. And the second half of 2012, the second term, they go below 50%. Informal and unemployed workers, they go below. They are less than 50% of the labor force in Venezuela, which is a clear indication of
clear indicator of what we can use in order to understand the history in Venezuela, all the important changes that took place. And at all spheres, the material spheres and the spiritual sphere, but mostly the material sphere. According to what I think, that underproletariat, the Chavez called marginalized classes, and of course he did not mean any negative implication whatsoever in this characterization. And very few times Chavez used this term to talk to poor in Venezuela, but regardless of how he used to call the people or all those denominators, the most important thing is to remember that this is the basis of the Bolivarian Revolution. Chavez was a government for all social classes in Venezuela, including the bourgeoisie. Everyone could see advantages in Chavez's government, including the Bolivarian population, of course. And there was a more democratized redistribution of the oil rent in the society. And the bourgeoisie also took its share during this time, but mostly the poor classes. And actually, the middle class and the upper classes made a lot of money during this period. But Chavez had in mind was to create a social mission in order to address the social debt. He wanted to address the needs of the proletariat. He wanted to address the needs of the poor. This was at the very essence of the revolution. And it is
a su proletariado, buena parte del cual la clase trabajadora
he built his own project. And in this project, he also took into consideration the working class, not only the proletariat, but the whole of the population. The society started to have a more decent social condition after. And some of us called the new class the new middle class Venezuela, but it was not middle class. To this day, it was not the middle class, it was the working class. So a portion of the working class that started belonging to the middle class that before in the past had no access to those conditions of the middle class. If you were a working class before, you were always confronting very precarious conditions. So this is at the center of the revolutionary policy. And it is understanding this concept that Chavez built the democratic hegemony in Venezuela. And after, in my opinion, it is bearing in mind this new fragmentation of the society that Chavez understood very clearly, and as I said, he was at odds with the traditional forms of mediation, he was at odds with the classical political parties, but it was thinking about this new transformation of the society and of his new classes that he had a quite different experience with the political institutions. It is thanks to this new conception, this new vision that he created communes and other ways of social organization. But we are going to focus on communes because this is a key element to the whole process. And during those years, there were some tensions inside the Bolivarian process. Why? Because, well, it is a national process. This is why I wanted to start reading the 12 pieces, because this is what makes Chavismo a different moment.
there was, as I said before, a epistemological
process.
Does that mean that everything was going to start from zero? No. Chavez took into consideration several aspects. There was certain continuity from the old policy, and there is still many, there are still many elements of the representation system in our revolution. There are reminiscences also of political traditional parties, because this is all being constructed as we move forward. That is when we could talk about socialism in 2004-2005. Obviously, he was not talking about the traditional socialism. When he started talking about socialism of the 21st century, he meant the modern ways of socialism. So, many things happen over time, of course. A revolution in our land was, of course, evidence of many of the several transformations that were taking place. And there are many contradictions in human. And in these contradictions, we see a tension between the inclusion logic and the participation logic, on which I insist constantly. This is what characterizes the Bolivarian revolution, the Bolivarian experiment, so to speak. And this makes it possible for Chavismo to emerge the idea of participation, protagonistic participation of the masses, of the people. So if you allow me, on the inclusion topic, on this participation and this tension, inclusion and participation, I would like to make a few comments. So, we have not insisted enough on the theoretical revolution. This is very clear to us. Chavez talked about epistemological breaking up as a bridge that allows you to go from democracy to a revolution, or that allows the revolution to continue without leaving aside the democracy. And this was pretty much present in all the documents of the movement, the MLB 200 movement. This is the new conception of the whole movement. But it was decisive also to determine the relationship with the popular majority. The Bolivarian movement did not consider the subject as a passive actor. It is an equal actor. It is a protagonistic actor. It is what we understand by the term or the figure of the communes. So the effects that it had on the majorities, on the people, without taking into consideration or understanding this breaking up as the rationale based on the representation system is not at odds with the continuity of what existed in the past. Without understanding this breaking up, it is no way to understand as a process. And then the
history
of Chavez in 1998. We cannot understand without considering this breaking up why the National Constituent Assembly took place. What happened in 1999? What happened in 2002 was a popular country coup, and all the sabotage of the business class at the end of 2003. It is not possible to understand the referendum of 2004. While President Chavez was in his tenure, it is not impossible, it is not possible to understand all the political currents that opposed Chavez. So it is important to understand this idea of the protagonist participation of the people. It is within this atmosphere that Chavez called for a constituent assembly. And the first laws in order to gain sovereignty on the economics were approved. It was approved the law for the land, the law for the health system. And once achieved this goal, he started to the social debt, the social issues. And he always talked about the social issues as the social debt. And he created the missions. And the missions were like a parallel institution. And then he created a new way of understanding institutions that will create a new state of justice in order to guarantee the free exercise of social and cultural rights for all the population. So with the creation of the mission, and thanks to the new redistribution of the rent, thanks to these new visions, he obtained the favor of the people who approved him. And the popular protagonism was also a key element, because little by little we started seeing tensions between the people who were protagonists and the people who had been excluded, because those who were excluded were just passive actors who received the benefits of the social aids. And the book that I wrote, I made an exercise of the varied ways in which this tension took place. It was from this tension between the protagonism and the exclusion that some names were created, such as oficialismo, officialism, so to speak. So this has to do with the representation system. The official sector, so to speak, cannot really understand the people's protagonism, who are now expecting more than a rentier system. And because they were practicing the traditional ways of doing businesses. Now, it is what happened when the public sector is using the old policies in order to address the social needs. So I said that in 2007, we see a watershed moment where we, in my opinion, we started seeing a global phenomenon of Chavismo who was separating from the official sector. Of course, it is not as simple as that. Because we first saw this as a trend, but in time, this became something that was almost impossible to reverse. Chavez then reoriented the creation of communes that were self-governance institutions, and he sponsored the creation of bigger communes. And in 2011, he relaunched the social missions that went back to 2003, 2004. He created the Great Housing Mission, with the self-governance element at the center of his actions. And he was always
telling
to the people how to give the people the protagonist and how to overcome obstacles that you encounter when you try to deal with this kind of initiatives of providing housing to the poor. We are back to the discussion, okay? So we would like to thank Professor Reinaldo Iturriza for his presentation. And he mentioned many issues. Of course, he talks about the origin of the Bolivarian Revolution, but mostly he talked about Chavismo as the center object of this whole process, and how from Chavez's perspective were born the different initiatives, reflections, and also how Chavez understood the process. Now, what we want to do now is to listen to the comments of our panelists, the panelists that I introduced at the beginning, so that you can give us your contribution. And we would like to thank Professor Iturriza, that in spite of all inconvenience that we are going through due to the blockade we are confronting, he was able to deliver his speech. So we will now ask the participants to intervene. Please ask your questions so that we can share our views. I just would like to say that at this first session is just a starting point of a number of seminars or classes that we are going to have. Inshallah, has the floor.
I think it was very, very important in what Professor Iturriza was saying, tracing the ideas back to the 1990s, before Chavez became president. And I think that gives also a very good context as to the kind of development, because I feel that there is this interaction between the people who proposed ideas such as communes, etc. But then, of course, then there's also the need and the whole mobilization of the people. And I think Professor Iturriza spelled this out very beautifully. What I would like to highlight is the question about the communes. When a delegation of our Chinese friends went to Venezuela in 2008, and attended a conference on the question of the future of humanity. We had, of course, the honor of meeting with President Chavez, and then at that time we were also introduced to a lot of the practices on the ground, and we were very impressed with what was happening on the ground, both in the urban and also in the rural areas. So I have one question that I would like our other panelists to respond to, which is that Chavez proposed the idea of commune or nothing in 2012. So that prompted the formation a lot of communal councils and communes, although they were already being proposed before. So the idea of commune or nothing is gives a lot of importance to communes. So how has been this motto being taken up, both conceptually and also in practice, from 2012 until now? So, I was also in Venezuela in January this year, and we were very impressed to see the development of the communes. So I also feel that in the coming sessions in this Venezuela series, we will be very happy to listen directly to some of the practitioners on the ground. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Gracias, Kinchi. Vamos entonces ahora con...
Thank you, Kinchi. No. Now we will listen to comments from Carlos Rom from the Simon Bolivar Institute.
Bueno, gracias, Hernán.
Thank you, Hernán. Well, I would like to say that Professor Iturriza's presentation was very important to understand the context that preceded the recent events in Venezuela,
and he explained the Bolivarian movement very well. So the question that was asked by Professor Quintilu under the motto commune or nothing was the banner of Chavismo. That was the main motto, the main motivation for the construction of a process that is undergoing, that is still taking place, the creation of the commune. And I think that there has been a transformation regarding what Professor Iturriza said, the movements who are protecting those communes and those first initiatives. And they took those initiatives to a higher level. And I would also say that the capability to the recent years with the blockade under the presidency of Maduro, the blockade and the aggression by the US administration that has intensified. And actually they attack us because of this commune movement. The commune movement was the visible face of Venezuela to the international world, right? So now this is the reason why they have intensified their aggressions. But due to these aggressions, I think that communes take a new momentum. They take new forces. And we relaunched that movement with greater force. So the creation of communes, of course, was conceived by President Chavez many years before. And with the motto, commune or nothing, explains this. But the economic warfare and the limitations that have been imposed to the Venezuelan government, we started to respond with more popular organization, with more action by the commune. Today, Venezuela is under siege, is a blockade country. We are suffering an economic that prevent us due to these coercive measures from having access to food, from having access to necessary inputs, from having access to raw materials that are essential to the day-to-day life. So that blockade has been responded by the communal forces, and it's thanks to the communal initiatives and actions that we have been able to subvert.
Y esto viene
we have tapped into, for instance, the agricultural production, which has helped us a great deal. And this has, of course, a very narrow relationship with the self-government initiative. As Iturriza said, what launched this principle of communal processes is the
de parte del Estado, porque el Estado das
also, this has the support of the government. The government makes it possible for the communes to maneuver, to build. So I think the motto is not only a motto as a symbol, it's not only a rhetorical issue. It's something that you can see on the day, in the day-to-day life.
Las comunas que en el interior tienen otras, por ejemplo, y cada una lleva su particularidad, pero es importante que ese sigue siendo como el eje motivador, ¿no? Y sobre todo en este tiempo de defensa del país ante la agresión más violenta que hemos visto hasta ahora. Sí, disculpe, tuve un problema ahí de audio. Pero solo para analizar y quizás seguir un poco la conversación, ¿no? Creemos que es importante que ese concepto, el común o nada, es lema, pero también es algo que nosotros mismos personificamos, llevamos, es parte de, más allá de un lema, es una guía de trabajo, en todos los niveles, tanto en los niveles de las organizaciones populares como a nivel de la gestión de Estado, a pesar de las dificultades, como decía, de este momento histórico, de la agresión, es el, digamos, el motor con que vamos impulsando todavía estas transformaciones. Gracias, Hernán.
Gracias a ti, Carlos. Tal como nos lo recordaban tanto Quinchi como Carlos, estamos en esta etapa entonces ya de comentarios a partir de cada uno de las compañeras, de los compañeros que están como organizadores, para dialogar con esta buena intervención que nos compartía el compañero Reinaldo Iturriza. Continuando entonces con esas reflexiones, seguimos ahora con Laura Capote, por la Secretaría Operativa de ALBA Movimiento.
Hola, bueno, compañeras, compañeros, pues primero un honor poder escuchar al compañero Iturriza y también entender, como decía Carlos anteriormente, pues esos componentes que permiten justamente la transformación de la comprensión de muchos conceptos a partir de la transformación que hacen ellos, el proceso bolivariano, el comandante Chávez, pero también el proceso comunal como tal en lo profundo, digamos, de la Venezuela, ¿no? Que es un poco este elemento de la posibilidad que nos representó no solamente hacia dentro de Venezuela, sino hacia lo continental, el inicio de un proceso, las características del proceso de la revolución bolivariana, ¿no? Es decir, el inicio de un proceso que tomara desde el Estado por ahí algunos elementos, conceptos inclusive, que desde los movimientos sociales o desde la izquierda en América Latina inicialmente serían, digamos, rechazados o no nos gustarían, como la imagen de un militar, o como hablar de la democracia o del Estado, digamos, por ahí esos conceptos que desde la tradición de la izquierda no necesariamente eran muy agradables, el proceso venezolano nos permitió comprender en profundidad que esos mismos conceptos y esas mismas denominaciones que nosotros diríamos burguesas en su momento, ¿no?, que tenían un fuerte componente, digamos, de las clases dominantes en nuestra región, podían tener otra perspectiva y podían tener otro significado, ¿no? Por ejemplo, hablar de del proceso comunal en Venezuela nos permite a nosotros pensar que ese constituyente primario, que ese elemento fundamental donde el comandante Chávez y Venezuela depositaban, digamos, la esencia de la democracia, ¿no?, que era el pueblo, las personas de las clases populares, podían transformar el significado de estos conceptos. Y eso más allá de lo que significó para Venezuela, significó, como nosotros y nosotras decimos en ALBA Movimientos, entre comillas, el mal ejemplo para la región, ¿no? Es decir, el ejemplo de que el problema no es si queremos o no democracia, por ejemplo, sino cuál es la democracia que nosotros queremos. En este caso, como nos la enseñó el comandante Chávez, una democracia popular y protagónica, una democracia que tenga a las clases populares como principales protagonistas y además que la construcción del Estado sea la construcción de un Estado comunal, pero hecho desde los territorios, con la realidad de los territorios, con la comprensión de los problemas que hay en los territorios, y que eso nos complejiza y nos pone el reto a los demás países de América Latina de lograr profundizar y encontrar estos elementos, estos retos en nuestros propios países y en lo continental, ¿no? Entonces, muchas veces, en este momento, ¿no?, también creo que es una buena excusa para hablar de lo que está sucediendo hoy en nuestra región, y es que estas clases dominantes, digamos, la posibilidad real de que el comandante Chávez, el proceso venezolano y otros procesos de nuestra región que lograron avanzar en la construcción de estados más democráticos con algunos elementos populares, como sucedió en el caso del Estado Plurinacional de Bolivia, o como sucedió en el caso de la Revolución Ciudadana en Ecuador, o como sucede en el caso de Nicaragua, de estos procesos más avanzados en nuestra región, eso nos permite, de alguna manera, pensar de qué manera vamos a o hemos logrado instalar algunos conceptos que inclusive hoy la derecha tiene que copiar, que hoy las clases dominantes tienen que copiar y tratar de cambiar el significado. por ejemplo, justamente el sentido de la democracia, el sentido de la defensa, por ejemplo, de la patria, ¿no? La patria que ha sido un proyecto continental para nosotros y nosotras, la patria grande, que ha sido un proyecto político del libertador y que el Simón Bolívar dejó justamente para que Hugo Chávez termine retomando. Ahora, inclusive la misma derecha tiene que tomar esos mismos conceptos y tratar de quitarle su contenido revolucionario y político, porque se logró, digamos, avanzar a un nivel del cual ya no se puede retroceder, ¿no? Y es hablar de la patria, de la democracia, de lo popular, hoy en América Latina es fundamental, y eso fue algo que nos permitió la Revolución Bolivariana, no solamente en términos discursivos, que también es muy importante, sino en términos concretos, ¿no? Conocer la experiencia comunal y conocer la perspectiva del Estado comunal y de la democracia popular y protagónica de Venezuela, para nosotros y nosotras nos pone un piso mínimo. De ahí en adelante lo que sigue, lo que nos queda, es profundizar aún más estas perspectivas, que es lo que vamos a ver en los siguientes encuentros. Pero me parece que, bueno, por supuesto, supremamente acertada la intervención del compañero Iturriza, y que nos pone a nosotros también el reto de ver ese ejemplo de lo comunal, cómo llevarlo, no sin decir, lógicamente llevarlo a partir de nuestras realidades, desde una perspectiva crítica, pero cómo tomarlo desde las realidades de otros países para hacer de este, digamos, una realidad posible, una idea de Estado a realizar como es el Estado comunal.
Gracias, Laura, por esas reflexiones.
Thank you, Laura, for those reflections. Now, Pablo Kunich has the floor. Very briefly, brothers and sisters, I would like to add from this presentation the subversive role of Hugo Chávez. His example, his legacy. We need to pursue the building of the communal state, which remains a goal, because this is complex to refund, to build a new type of society. And in the midst of these aggressions, we need to think on how to defend better our sovereignty. We consider that to defend sovereignty, we need to resort to a reinforced communal socialism. We cannot ignore it, since this is the very essence of Chavism. That at the moment of a structural crisis of capitalism and in the midst of the pandemic, it is clear that the capitalist model is exhausted, and we need to opt for a more collective model with full participation of the people. And that's the essence of the legacy of Chávez and the essence of the Chavista movement. It is a movement that is hand in hand with the government, but it should remain very critical of what is going on. Asian Network of Regional Integration. The second speaker has the floor.
Yeah. Thank you very much for Renato's lectures. And when we talk about revolution, and we also will talk about the land revolution, For example, in Asian experience, China and Vietnam has very successful land revolution. That means the Communist Party has nationalized all the land resources and let the majority, the peasants, has access to the land and also the food security and also all the livelihood security. So for the other Asian countries, they actually have still worked very hard for this land revolution. For example, in India, only three states like Kerala and also the West Bengal has land revolution. But for the others, actually, they can't achieve this. And in Indonesia, the Communist Party also worked very hard to achieve this goal. But in 1965, it stopped. And also because of the United States intervention, and also it's the this kind of land revolution stop. And I think this kind is this like unfinished project of the leftist party. So this is the first question should be, when we talk about revolution, how it relate to the land issue. And the second point is the we are very glad that the people power once again recognized in among the intellectuals, and also how to find the strength in this so-called the weakest link, because we find the power, people's power, but people always relate to the marginalized people. So I think Chavismo, this is one very important point, is that they try to think about go beyond the military, party, trade union, and intellectual, that means the elite, and then how to let these four sectors reconnect with the marginalized people and make it kind of broad alliance of peoples. That means we define the people's power. So I think this is very important for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Muchas gracias, Yadi. Y entonces,
thank you,
ahora,
Yadi. Cerrar esta ronda de comentarios. To close this comment session, and Xishan, if he has some comments, this time in Mandarin.
年初去年的时候有去过委内瑞拉，有一段时间，对那里有一定的考察和学习，但是今天我还是很难以去做一些什么总结，我就直接把我们在B站上的直播，有一些网友提出了一些问题，我想把这些问题。
I have collected some questions from visitors, and so we have 5,000, like 6,000 people here watching our live stream. So I have chosen three questions, and the first one is about the land policy of Venezuela. So he or she wants to ask if the land concentrated among large landlords in Venezuela, if land has been concentrated in the hands of a small number of large landlords, how does Venezuela promote rural development? How does Chavismo see land ownership? So what is the concept of commune in Venezuela? And what kind of organization is it, and how large is the commune? And what's the relationship between the commune with the current regime? Is it an NGO or is is the NGO, how can Camille participate in and express their need and whether they can influence political decision making? And the third question, they say that the traditional party politics has and we must directly people to participate. And so I want to ask, how is the development of a mass mobilization in Venezuela? For example, farmers, workers, and students, how's the organizing of this mass group? What's the relationship between the existing political system and this mass mobilization? So these are the three questions that were raised in the Bilibili. Thank you.
We have a number of questions. Questions posed by those following us from the People's Republic of China, close to 4,000 people. On our site, 67 people are following us. And we have several questions that we'd like to share so we can close by answering some of them. People ask, Carol Mowa, Becker, Diaz, Maria Martinez. There are a couple of questions regarding marginal classes. The question is, do they want to be equal to other social classes with different situations in the case of the indigenous people? In Canada, for instance, it is difficult to create equal conditions between the indigenous nations, working classes, and other classes like the bourgeoisie. Another question, just rather a reflection, a comment. How can we talk about excluded people if the hell of capitalism excludes every single one, especially the outcast, the marginalized, and the poor? Also, a couple of questions linked among themselves that has to do with the actual power of commune and commune members. How do they work? How they are organized? And it has to do with the last question posed by our friend from China. Regarding marginal classes, again, the question is, this is a comment rather, if these marginal classes have agency in socialism thanks to this rupture that occurred with the traditional left practices, left tradition, as called virtuous cycle, virtuous period, according to Professor Iturriza. How, another question, how we manage for the formalized workers do not ignore the non-formalized labor? So we have a wealth of questions and reflections. Well, this is just the first session of a seminar of 24 weeks. So I guess we will be revisiting these questions. We won't be able to answer them all today. However, we could give some answers in order to stimulate future analysis. In the coming four sessions, for instance, we will be able to debate these aspects with the commune members who will be assisting, attending this seminar in the coming weeks. So we need to keep those questions to pose them again when we have Che Guevara commune, Maizal commune, Alexis Viva Commune, and so on and so forth. I'd like to start with the organization of the commune, just to give you a few data. In regarding the size, in the commune ministry, we have close to 47,000 communal councils in urban and rural areas. According to the communal council's law, a communal council is created out of families living in a single territory, which could have 200, 500 families. But in the case of rural communities, we can organize the council with a lower number of households, fewer households. So a communal council is organized through elections. Families should determine who are the spokespersons that are part and parcel of the communal council. According to the law, the communal council should encompass all the households that live in the territory of the commune. And the citizens' assembly is the ruling body. There, they define in the assemblies what are the decisions that then become in mandates, guidelines for the spokespersons who were chosen among the community. There are several work committees, like water committee, land committee, food committee, women's rights committee, and so on and so forth. They create as many committees as they deem appropriate. These committees, chosen by the community, they are responsible for carrying out various tasks. Over the last 20 years, we have seen that the community councils became a synthesis of various types of organizations that used to exist in our countries in the past. Just to give you an example, in 2004, we have the Urban Land Committee as a community organization to assist in the process of regularize the ownership of the land in urban areas. Likewise, technical water committees, health committees, etc., in order to move forward in the adoption of policies. And they became a synthesis within the community, the communal council. Just to give you a broader idea of how these councils work in general terms. Of course, there have been a number of conflicts, tensions, conflicts, creative conflicts, as Garcia Linera says, that is part of the creation of this community fabric that has morphed in a process of mobilization, execution of projects, gathering of experience in community management. Some communal councils have been part of conflicts to have access to land and other services which are essential for life. Next, the creation of communes. Chavez proposes communes as part of self-government, the first cell for self-government. So those were called marginalized people. Well, progressively, Chavez transformed them in people, oppressed people, but we find various expressions of the labor people, of the workers, the indigenous people, the African descent people, the urban and rural
communities, men, feminist groups, migrant groups, etc. It must be the synthesis terrain, ground of oppressed people. So Chavez says that the commune should be the self-government unit. And there we have the agendas that would enable us to implement the communal development plan in order to address the social, economic, cultural challenges, territorial challenges that should be overcome by the community itself. There is a document that we need to share with you once we are able to translate it. It was the first theoretical Alo Presidente, a conference delivered by Chavez, and there he talks to the people through TV, and there he gave guidelines on how to create the communes. So on the one side, he gave a reference, like in China, the Soviets, in the Soviet Union. He explained the Zapatista movement in Mexico. He also refers to Marxism, but also libertarian socialism, and so on and so forth. And based on that, he made a number of reflections, saying that the commune should be socialism in the territory with the agency of the people, self-government, with its own productive model, and should go beyond the quantity. It should go to the cultural revolution from the territory. I mentioned this with the basic elements of the commune because from this onward, over the last years, we have created a number of communes which are the center of various communal councils based on the different characteristics. In Venezuela so far, we have 3,200 communes spread around the country. And those have a reference of what Iturriza mentioned as the process of agency, the rupture of the traditional power models. So many of the questions asked have to do with the open debates that exist within the communes. And in the communes, we find many movements that perhaps are not recognized as communes, but we recognize that the communal project is the place where communes can join together, can team up in order to produce what is common. And from the spirit of the commune, we have a common factor. And this is the basis of many of the analysis. So based on what Reinaldo said and based on the questions you have posed, we need to use those elements for future reflections. We need to build identity in the struggling subject, in the popular subject. That is of the essence. And there we still have many things to do. Iturriza mentioned about the reflections of the Chavez-led movement in the 80s, how they debated about the people, the men talk about the marginalized people. Today, we are talking about the struggling people that over the last period, the last years of the blockade, have been suffering a lot from this blockade, have had many difficulties to meet
their necessities. But in the midst of this task, this community fabric, communal fabric that has been created, has been part of this fabric that has enabled us to counteract and these attacks. Without community organization built over the last year, it would have been impossible to address the pandemic, to be able to do the tests among the population. It would have been impossible to provide health care to the affected people. The case of Guasdualito mentioned from then up to now, well, close to 40,000 people of Venezuelans returning to Venezuela, they have come through Guasdualito, for instance. And those people have been welcomed by the communities, by the communals, together with the governments, together with their armed force, together with the health workers. It's been a joint effort that have enabled to provide health care, housing, food provision, and so on. And the treatment during confinement, etc. This period of resistance was possible thanks to the communes whose production has increased. I'm talking about commune as the territory of the small producer, small people producing with difficulties, but they're still guaranteeing food supply to the community and to the surrounding areas. So do communes generate alternative production systems? Well, we will be debating about this in the coming sessions. However, we have observed how much of the food we eat in Venezuela comes from the peasants, from family producers. Also, we observe that many communes in rural and urban areas, they have connections, they are linkages. And we will see that also in sessions. They are not intermediaries between rural and urban areas. Those who want self-sufficiency, and they are discussing about the need to have the land, and there is a dispute on land in Venezuela, and it has been essential over the last 200 years. It's a reason of tensions between the land owner, the bourgeoisie, and the rural owners who want the land. So it is important to say that this commune spirit has to do with people, a people that have resisted and have defended flags which are essential. Peace, to begin with, democracy, sovereignty, and the need to build a dignified future for the majority of the country. And those are key elements in our society, and we should continue debating the legacy of Chavez, but these are key elements. And in closing, much of what has built so far has to do with the situation in Venezuela that has changed dramatically, as Reinaldo said. Venezuela today, that in the 90s was informalized with the Bolivarian Revolution regarding inclusion, we have included a lot, and we have provided people the elements to have better salaries.
Estado del bloqueo ha vuelto a una etapa de profunda informalización Y yo creo que ese es importante, un tema importante de debate porque...
And I think this is an important topic for the debate because then we confronted the crisis, the economic crisis.
Creo que la pandemia ha traído...
And the pandemic as well, which has led to a globalization of the different kinds of work we can do. And I think that the vast majority of the population in the world is made up by the peasants, by the workers, small producers, women who work from the communities at home. And the numbers say that 70% of the population in Asia is a population working in the informal sector. And I am sure that the coronavirus is going to have an impact on that. And work that we do through the internet is just an example of what we're seeing today with all the positions of modernity. I am sure that we will continue this discussion in the forthcoming session. We are about to finish today's session. I would only like to ask the panelists if someone wants to say something to make some final remarks before we finish today's session. And first of all, I would like to thank all the participants, our friends that are following us from Latin America, from Europe, from the United States, from Africa, and from Asia. From China, greetings to those 4,000 activists and students that have been following us over recent times. And I would also like to thank all the organizers, the Institute, the Simon Bolivar Institute, the Global University for Sustainability, the Center for Cultural Research and Development, Green Ground, ALBA Movements, and the Continental Platform, to thank our friends, brothers and sisters from ALBA TV, and to thank all the technical equipment that have helped us, our interpreters that have worked very hard and will continue working so that we can understand each other in English, Spanish, and Mandarin. Thank you very much for the interpreters. I would like to thank the technical equipment, also the technical team, made it possible for us to be here today. And just a few comments from on the chats to answer some of the chat questions. This platform is going to be available. It's going to be available for the next sessions. And in streaming, they tell me that there were more than 6,000 people following. And the idea is to provide this class in the different languages and the portals of the Global University for Sustainability, the Simon Bolivar Institute, and ALBA Movement. And we will also share all the documents of the discussions. Very soon you will get a paper on the Professor Iturriza's presentation. And I would like to thank him, and I'm sorry that he could not attend the Q&A session, but greetings to him as well. And we invite you for next week, next Wednesday, who will follow with the second session. And in the second session, we will have a direct class with the rural communes, productive communes of our country. We will listen to Commune El Maizal, to different communes of our country, and you will be able to listen from the protagonists what is happening to understand the whole process. This will be a very nice class, I'm sure of it. So this is all I want to say. I want to close and say it. We will prevail, and the commune are nothing.